So I'm going to be talking a lot about Mary. Does anyone here love Mary? Yeah, all right. Well, we're going to get to know Mary a little better through this process of walking with her in the Gospel of Luke. And I'm going to be drawing a lot from, I don't know, how many of you are familiar with the book I wrote on this topic called Walking with Mary, A Biblical Journey from Nazareth to the Cross. So I'm going to be drawing a lot from this work, which, you know, a lot of my life has been spent on studying the biblical passages about Our Lady, writing about Our Lady. My doctoral dissertation was on the Blessed Virgin Mary, on Mary's queenship, a biblical understanding of her as Queen Mother. And then I found myself writing books on the Rosary and apologetics about Mary, explaining Marian doctrine, Marian devotion. But over the course of the last maybe 5 years or so, as I started really reading a number of writings from Joseph Ratzinger, Pope Benedict, and John Paul II, I became drawn toward seeing in the scriptures a lot more about what I call the human Mary. The human Mary. How many of you know the human Mary? You know, we all know the Mary of doctrine pretty well, right? The Immaculate Conception, she's the Mother of God, she's assumed into heaven, she's the perpetual virgin, ever-virgin woman. So we think about the Mary of doctrine, and we know the Mary of our statues that we have in our various churches, or the Mary of stained glass windows, and we sing songs about Mary, Salve Regina, Hail Holy Queen, Immaculate Mary. But how many of you know the human Mary? The human Mary, what was Mary going through step by step throughout her life? What was going on inside? How many of you know and understand what St. John Paul II called Mary's interior journey of faith, her interior pilgrimage of faith? What I do in the book is I identify 9 key steps, so 9 key steps of faith that Mary took in her life, and you could break that down with other numbers and maybe cover other scenes, but I focused on 9 key steps of faith that we can see in Mary's life from sacred scripture, and that's what I want to look at with all of you this afternoon. So can we start with a prayer? I think it'd be good to say a Hail Mary with the talk on Mary. So in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So whenever I talk about Mary's humanness, Mary's journey of faith in Scripture, I always love to tell a story about my daughter, Josephine. Some of you may have heard me tell this story before. It's a story I think all of you can relate to. Have you ever seen a child take their first steps? Have you ever witnessed that, when a baby takes their first step? Little Josephine, she's 5 now and very bubbly and energetic, but when she was just about 1, she was on a retreat with me and my family and a whole bunch of our students at the Augustine Institute, and all of the professors. We begin our school year going up into the Rocky Mountains, and we do a retreat. We have a big cabin. We pray together. We sing around the fire. We give testimonies. It's a great fellowship, you know, for the beginning of the year. And the families come along so they can participate in this. And little Josephine, you know, she had been thinking about the walking thing a number of times. Do you ever see a baby? They'll crawl to a chair like this, and they'll kind of like stand up, you know, hold themselves up, or they crawl over to a coffee table and they try to stand. Just hold themselves. You know what I'm talking about? That's what Josephine, she had done that many times, and she did it that afternoon. We were in the lodge, and in the middle of this big cabin here, all the students were sitting in a circle, and there was a chair in the middle, and little Josephine saw it, so she crawled up to the chair, and she stood up, and she was all proud, and she was all excited, and all the students started cheering her on because they wanted to see her take her first step. So they started cheering, Josephine! Josephine. And I was over here saying, come on, baby, you could do it. Take those first steps. You know, and then she'd go like this. You know, she'd let go with one hand, think about it, go, nah, I don't know. I think I want to hold on to the security of the chair. And she'd look again, oh, maybe. No, I don't know if I want to do that. Well, eventually, she let go with one hand again, which she had done many times. But then she did something she had never done before. She let go with a second hand. And she was now standing on her own 2 feet. And she was just glowing with pride and excitement. And everyone's really cheering her on now. Josephine, Josephine, go, come on, baby. But then, you know what happened? All of a sudden, her legs started to go like this. And instead of excitement, her face quickly turned to horror. And she desperately went backwards to cling to the security of the chair. And she looked over at me as if to say, hey, Dad, what are you trying to make me do? But eventually she got her footing again. She felt comfortable, and she let go with one hand, and she let go with the second hand. But this time, when her legs got a little wobbly, instead of going backwards toward the security of the chair, little Josephine fell forward. One, two, three, into my arms, and she took her first steps. But then she crawled right back to that chair, stood up and said, again? She said, one, two, three, four. And she crawled back and she said, again? One, two, three, four, five. And we played that game for like an hour that afternoon. We played that game for several weeks back at home. And you know what? Eventually, walking became Josephine's primary mode of transportation. But that whole idea of a little child stepping out into the unknown, taking that first step, that could be scary. And it's not just for little children. It's also true for us adult children of God. If we ever sense the Lord standing out here like this, trust me, you can do it. Take this step. I know you've never done this before. I know you've never experienced this before. I know you've never endured this kind of difficulty before, but trust me, I'm here. You know, this is the way God works. You know this from all your study of Scripture, right? Whenever God calls someone, he tells them to just, you know, sit down and relax because life's just going to be very comfortable and easy, right? That's not what God does. He's always calling us on to take that next step forward in trust and surrender so that he can change us and mold us and draw us closer to himself and then use us to share his love with others more effectively in the world, right? Remember the story of Abraham, of course? Abraham is called to go to a distant land, where he doesn't know anybody. He's leaving his family behind. He's going to go off to this distant land of Canaan. We know the story of Moses. Remember Moses there at the burning bush? We often think, wow, what an amazing event that was. He got to talk to God, and then he got to become the leader of Israel. I mean, that's better than a political party's national convention. I mean, he just became the leader of Israel. Isn't that amazing? But if you think about it, remember, did Moses really want that job? Remember, he tries every trick in the book to get out of it. I'm not eloquent. I can't speak well. They're not going to believe me. I'm not a leader. And God encourages him and calls him to take this step of faith. Joshua was called to lead the people into the promised land where there are these large armies ready to pounce upon the Israelites. Joshua's called. David's called to go become king. He's the youngest of all the brothers in this family. He doesn't have much leader experience. He was just a shepherd boy, and God calls him forth. He does this with the saints beyond the Bible, whether it's someone like St. Ignatius of Loyola, or whether it's a modern saint like Saint Mother Teresa, about to be St. Mother Teresa, who was very happy serving as the middle class, as a teacher there in Calcutta, and then one day God called her to leave all that behind, to leave her beloved Loreto sisters behind that she had been a part of for many years, and to go out onto the streets and live the life of the poorest of the poor. And like Moses, she says, I'm not worthy, choose someone else. I don't want to live that Indian life. I can't do this. I'm too attached to my own comfort. And she was scared. She was nervous, and God called her. What's God calling you to do in your life? Maybe you're not called to go start a religious order. Your spouse will kill you if you do that. Maybe you're not called, you know, to go move to some distant city, but maybe it's a small calling. Maybe God's just kind of knocking on the door of your heart and saying, I want you to trust me a little more in a certain area. Or maybe, you know, maybe it's your finances. Maybe he's saying, I want you to, you know, it's the year of mercy. I want you to give more to the poor. You're very comfortable, but there are a lot of people that don't know how they're going to get by day to day. Can you be more sacrificial in your giving? Not comfort giving, but sacrificial giving. Maybe that's what God's calling you to do. Or maybe there's someone in your life that you just have not forgiven. This person really hurt you, and you're not overlooking the hurt, but you're going beyond it, And you're going to say, I forgive you to this person. Maybe there's just some behavior you have that, you know, you're looking at something or you're doing something you shouldn't be doing, and you know I shouldn't do this, and maybe God's calling you to change. Maybe God's calling you to step up and play more of a leadership role in your parish. Maybe you've never led a small group Bible study before, but you're sensing maybe God's asking me to. I don't know what's going on, but we all have these moments in life, and they're pretty regular, where it's just God's inviting us to take that next step. The same is true with the Blessed Virgin Mary. You know, Mary, she was given unique graces like no one else. Singular privileges. She is the Immaculata, full of grace. But we can't forget that even though she was given those utterly unique gifts, she still was human. And she experienced many human things. So, for example, she experienced the joys of friendship with her kinswoman Elizabeth. She couldn't wait to share this good news with her dear kinswoman. She experienced the joys of parenthood, being a mother. She experienced the blessings of walking in God's ways. This is a Mary I can relate to. When I look at Mary, the Immaculate One, so I go, wow, she never sinned, and I sin many times every day. Or she's gonna, you know, she went up to heaven right away after she died, and I'm, you know, I'm gonna be down in the ground for, you know, till the end of time. Sometimes we can put Mary on this pedestal in such a way that she's almost just so far removed. We admire her from afar, but we can mistakenly think, well, whatever happened in her life doesn't relate to me. Well, no, it does. You know, because Mary also, she had to go through difficulties like we do. She had challenges where it wasn't clear what was happening, where she had to discern, what is the Lord doing right now? Why is the Lord allowing this to happen? What is the Lord asking of me? She had moments of great sorrow, moments of uncertainty, moments of darkness. There's even a line in Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, we'll look at later, that says that Mary did not understand. Now, granted, she probably understood more than anyone else because of the graces she received and the special revelation she got, but yet she still had to walk by faith and not by sight. And there were some times where she's walking in such darkness, the only thing she could do is to keep and ponder all these things in her heart. As I started reading more from St. John Paul II and Pope Benedict on their writings about Mary, it was really opening up not just the Mary of doctrine and the Mary of devotion, but the human Mary in this interior journey of faith. And as I said, I think we could see in Scripture 9 key moments where the Lord is inviting Mary to take another step of faith, inviting her to trust more, to surrender more, to give more, to love more, and to follow him ever more closely. And these 9 steps of faith we can see in Scripture can really inspire us in our own walk with the Lord. Now, we're going to focus on Luke's Gospel, because that's the theme for today. And so we're not going to go through all those 9 steps, but I want to walk through a number of them that we see in Luke. And in Luke's Gospel, one of the things we get to consider is the very first presentation of Mary's great faith, in the Bible at least. So who could tell me, where do we see Mary's great faith first in sacred Scripture? At the Annunciation, okay, and where in the Annunciation? What did Mary do at the Annunciation? She said yes. She gave her fiat. Do you all agree with that? So that's where we see Mary's first? Raise your hands if you agree. Okay, you're all wrong. But I would have said that too before 2008, 2009, until I read something from Pope Benedict that made me realize, oh, there's actually something earlier in Scripture. That's a crucial moment. Don't get me wrong. We're going to talk about that one too, her fiat. But there was something even earlier in Scripture that bears witness to Mary's incredible faith. It comes in the Annunciation scene, but not at the end, not with her, be it done unto me according to your will. It comes at the very beginning. Let's take a look at the beginning of the Annunciation scene. If you open up your Bibles, you could turn to Luke's Gospel, chapter 1, verses 26 through 28. And in those verses, we're going to read a couple facts about who Mary was, what she was going through, what her life was like. Admittedly, the Bible doesn't tell us a lot about Mary in her early years. What was the pre-Annunciation Mary like? What was her life like before that fateful day when the angel Gabriel came to her? Well, as you start, it says in Luke chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. There's not a lot of detail here, but if you want to get a little window into what was Mary's life like before the angel came, it's these are the two key verses you need to consider. Let's milk them for all they're worth. What do we learn? I think we can learn three or four things from here. First of all, it tells us that Gabriel goes to a city of Galilee named Nazareth. Nazareth. Now, Nazareth, I think you know, was just an insignificant village in the first century. It's not famous for anything. It's not known for anything. There's no great expectation about Nazareth. In fact, the point that Jesus is raised in Nazareth will cause him trouble when he's older. Remember what Nathaniel says? Can anything good come out of Nazareth? I mean, it kind of had a bad reputation. Large Gentile population up in the region of Galilee. So what's Nazareth? What could come out of Nazareth? Can you think of small, insignificant towns or cities that, you know, you would just never guess anything amazing would come from? If you think about the new evangelization, oh, it's going to come from New York City, you know, the Big Apple, or maybe Hollywood and Los Angeles, but Steubenville, Ohio? I went to school here, and it's amazing. My friends and I have been talking about just all of the graduates who have gone out, and they're assuming these leadership positions in parishes and dioceses and all these amazing movements. What this university has done to help raise up a generation of leaders is absolutely astounding. So don't always judge things by their appearance from the outside. Can anything good come out of Steubenville? Indeed, a lot of good has come out of Steubenville. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? You wouldn't have expected it, but the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ came from there. So Mary lives in nowhere Nazareth. That's the first point we can get. Second thing, she's betrothed. Now, what's betrothal? What does that mean? What does that tell us? A lot of Americans, we think that means that Mary was engaged. We think that means Mary was engaged to Joseph. That's how we translate it sometimes in our own heads. But that's not quite accurate. That's not as precise. And there was a two-stage marriage process. And the first step of marriage is betrothal. So when I teach in the university setting, I'll ask the students, okay, true or false, Mary was engaged to Joseph before Gabriel came. True or false? Oh, I'm sorry, let me give you the question again. I gave a bad question, sorry. Mary was married to Joseph before Gabriel came. True or false? Ooh, see, you're all mixed. The answer is actually true. She's married right now. Betrothal is the first step of marriage. It's when bride and groom come together, they exchange vows, it's a public event. There is a lifelong covenant now established between the man and the woman, in this case, between Mary and Joseph. They are legally married right now. Now, they haven't reached the second stage of marriage. The second stage of marriage over here would be when they come together under the same roof. They live together, and that's when a marriage would be consummated. So, are Mary and Joseph married? Yes. Are they living together? No. If they were just an ordinary Jewish couple, would they have had sexual relations? You know, not yet, because that would happen later. Now, in their case, it's a unique thing, so we can talk about that later. But right now, I want you to know she's legally married right now to Joseph. She's just living with Anne and Joachim at this point. She's not under the same roof as Joseph. But I think what's most significant about this point of her betrothal is that she is someone who would have been very young. Many Jewish girls would have been betrothed around the age of 13, maybe 14 years old. So picture, very likely Mary is a very young girl by our standards at this moment, living in nowhere Nazareth, betrothed to Joseph. And the last point, which is probably the most significant, is that the one she's betrothed to is of the house of David. He's of the house of David. Now, you all know what that means. Like the David, that's the famous family. That's the royal family. David was given a great promise that his dynasty would last forever and of his kingdom there would be no end. And so there's this great hope for a future son of David to restore the Davidic dynasty, to rebuild the kingdom and extend it to the ends of the earth. So the fact that Mary's betrothed not just to any ordinary family, but the royal family of David, would for us as readers be pretty exciting. We'd be wondering, wow, I wonder if maybe this is going to be the family from which the great king will come, the Messiah. So that's just a little bit of background. But when it comes to Mary's first step of faith, we see it next. Because in Luke 1:28, the angel comes and appears to Mary and says these words, "Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you." Now, how does Mary respond? How does Mary's response, how would you describe it? What's going on inside of Mary? So what emotion do you think was going on inside of Mary? What does the Bible tell us? Angel comes, says those words. How does Mary feel? Is she like, oh, cool, an angel? What's the emotion the Bible describes her having? She was greatly troubled, right? That's what it says in Luke 1:29. She was greatly troubled. What does the angel have to say to her? Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. So Mary is greatly troubled inside. She's experiencing some fear and trepidation. What's going on here? Why was Mary so troubled? I always used to think it was because she saw an angel, right? If you're in the middle of the day and you're doing, you know, dishes in the kitchen, all of a sudden you turn around and there's an archangel there, I'd be freaking out too. That would be really freaky. Wow, look at that. Here we've got an angel. Oh my goodness. I would be greatly troubled. Greatly troubled. Now, Mary is greatly troubled, but if you read the text carefully in Luke 1:29, is she greatly troubled over the sight of the angel? It says she's greatly troubled at the saying. Now, I want you to consider something earlier. The previous scene, Gabriel visited 6 months ago another person. Do you remember who that was? Zechariah, John the Baptist's dad. And when the angel appears, look at what it says in Luke 1:12. Luke 1:12. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. So he goes into the temple, he goes into the holy place, and he sees the angel of the Lord standing to the side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him. So Zechariah sees an angel and is troubled. But in Luke 1:29, we read that Mary's not troubled about the sight of the angel. She's more troubled by what the angel said. And she considers in her mind what sort of greeting this might be. Now, what's so troubling about these words? Is that really troubling? If I say to all of you, "The Lord be with you," what do you say? Right? Because you know the New Mass Translation. Did Mary know the New Mass Translation? Did she know the old one? She didn't know the old one either, right? Because it hadn't been instituted yet. But for a good, pious Jewish woman, an ordinary Jewish woman, what would those words, "The Lord be with you," what would those words have meant to her? Those words are used over and over in the Bible when God is calling someone on a certain mission. We've already talked about some of those great heroes in salvation history who had a great calling, like Moses at the burning bush. What does God say to him over and over again? "I will be with you, Moses. I will be with you." When Joshua had to go lead the people into the promised land, what did God say? "Be courageous, Joshua." Why? "Because I will be with you. I'll be with you to help you to do what you can't do on your own." Gideon heard those words in Judges chapter 6, verse 12, when he's called to go fight off the Midianites. Gideon has no military experience. He's not a soldier. He's not a leader. And he's wondering, "Well, how can I do this?" And the angel says, "The Lord will be with you." David heard those words at the beginning of his dynasty. The prophets heard those words when they were called in their prophetic ministry. So now, put yourself in Mary's shoes. Here you are in the middle of your day, and all of a sudden an angel appears to you, and the first thing the angel says to you is, "The Lord is with you." What are you thinking? Uh-oh. That's right. Uh-oh. In other words, that's biblical code for you're going to be called to something daunting, where you're going to be stretched like never before, and you're going to have to rely on God like never before. And so Mary knows something big is about to be asked of her. She doesn't know what it is yet, But she knows this is something that's going to be very challenging. And so, natural response, she's greatly troubled. And here's the practical point I want to give for all of you. You know, there's times in our lives where we sense God may be calling us to do something, to make a change, to be more generous, to love more, to serve more, to sacrifice more, to give more of our time, you know, whatever the issue might be. You know, so God's over here, and he may be inviting us to take that next step forward. And when you sense that, is there a part of you that goes, uh-oh? Is there a part of you that kind of dreads it? Is there a part of you that's scared? Is there a part of you that's greatly troubled? Yeah, that's natural. That's natural. So on one hand, be encouraged. Don't beat yourself up if you notice, you know, I wish I was just more, you know, easily generous and just easily did God's will. I'm a little greatly troubled about this. But no, Mary experienced that as well. Jesus experienced this himself. He's the divine Son of God. So these two wonderful people, you've got the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Immaculata, who never sinned, who's full of grace, and Jesus, the divine Son of God, Jesus, the night before he dies, is sweating like drops of blood coming out, and it's intense. Lord, if it be possible, let this cup pass. He's feeling the weight of what's going to happen the next day. It's intense. That's natural. But here's the key. Here's the challenge to us. Did Mary or Jesus allowed their knowing of what was going to happen, or in Mary's case, you know, her being greatly troubled, did she allow her emotions to control her? Did she allow her fear to control her? No. Is it natural to have fear? Yeah, that's natural. In fact, St. Thomas Aquinas says it's not virtuous to have no fear. You know those t-shirts some kids wear, no fear? That's actually not virtuous. As a husband, I should fear death. As a just human being, I should fear death, but especially as a husband and a father of 8 children, you know, I just don't go, oh, I might die, okay, no big deal. No, there should be a part of me that says, I'm not going to put myself in harm's way and risk without, you know, unless there's some good reason to, because I shouldn't just have no fear, because my life matters. God has a plan for me here on earth. So it's actually not virtuous to have no fear at all, but we don't want to be enslaved by our fears. The Blessed Virgin Mary experienced in herself, she was greatly troubled. She knows something big is about to be asked of her, but you know what she does? Here's the key. She considers in her mind what sort of greeting that might be. So if you mark up your Bibles, you can circle that word considered or underline it. I'm going to tell you about it, or you can make a note if you're just taking notes. But the word considered here in Greek is the word from which we get the word dialogue in English. And this particular word, Pope Benedict mentions, describes an intense, extended reflection that triggers faith. So there's this intense inner reflection going on. And listen to what Pope Benedict says about this. He says, Mary enters into an interior dialogue with the Word. So there's this deep reflection. She's talking to God. She knows that God is asking something of her. She doesn't know what it is, but she's going to remain in conversation and dialogue with God about this. Lord, what is it that you're asking of me? Are you wanting me to do this? How can I respond? Well, she's talking to God about it. Benedict goes on to say, she carries on an inner dialogue with the Word that has been given her. She speaks to it and lets it speak to her. So Mary has an open heart. That's the first step of faith I want to highlight here. She knows something big is about to be asked of her. She's a little nervous about it, but she's open to God about it. She's truly open, and she's saying, Lord, might you be asking this of me? Lord, how do you want me to respond? Lord, how can I serve you? She's talking to God about it. You know what many of us do when we sense, you know, God, I think God wants me to go tell my wife sorry for, you know, something I said this morning. And instead of having this open conversation with God, oh, Lord, did I not treat Beth well? Maybe I should go say sorry. You know what sometimes I sadly do? Sometimes I go, well, no, but she said it first. Or, you know, if she hadn't done this, I get defensive, I put up a wall, and I'm not talking to God about it. I'm just talking in my own head, trying to justify my own action. Do you ever do that? You know, or I sense maybe God wants me, you know, to make a change in my life. And I'm like, whoa, hold on. I don't want to make a change. And so do you ever do this? You know, we say, God, whatever you want, God, but but not this, 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 or this. Whatever you want, except these 27 and a half things. We put a parameter around God's will in our lives, so we're not really talking to God about it. Or he says maybe God wants us to serve in maybe some new way, and we're a little nervous about it. But instead of talking to the Lord about it, we just kind of have this interior dialogue in our own head and ourselves, convincing ourselves why surely he's not asking me this. If you ever sense that knock on your heart from the Lord, and you're not certain that God's asking you to do something, you know, but you sense he might be, what do you lose from going to the chapel and talking to him about it? What do you lose by even when you're driving home from work, just turning off the radio and saying, Lord, this has been on my heart. I'm wondering, are you wanting me to do that? What do you lose by doing that? Nothing. Just talk to God. That's what Mary did. She carried on a dialogue with God. We tend to cut off the conversation because we're so scared. We allow our fear of what God may be calling us to do to control us. Mary rose above that and remained in dialogue with God. She considered in her mind what sort of greeting this might be. That's our first point to consider. Mary had an open heart. Now, let's go to the next step of Mary's walk with the Lord in the Gospel of Luke. And that comes at the end of the Annunciation scene. It's her fiat. But let's think about what goes on from the first step. She hears the Lord is with you, so she knows something big is about to be asked of her. Now the angel will download the mission to her. He's going to download to her, this is what you're called to do. You're going to have a child. You're going to have a child. How many moms here in the audience? Any moms out there? Do you remember when you first found out you were expecting? Do you remember that? Do you probably remember where you were? You know, you can picture that moment. That's an amazing moment right there. So just imagine you're Mary, and let's say the story just ended here. The angel says, you're going to have a baby. That's pretty exciting in itself. And we as readers would go, wow, that's cool. She's going to have a baby. But it gets better. The angel goes on to say, and this child will be great. He will be the Son of the Most High. And of his kingdom there will be no end. He will sit on the throne of his father Jacob forever. He uses all this language that comes directly from 2 Samuel chapter 7. 2 Samuel 7. Many biblical scholars commenting on the angel's words in verses 31 through 33 have a little chart where you can just map out what the angel Gabriel says and then what God said to David. That David will have a son, David's son will be great, he will be a son of, like a son of God, son of the Most High. He will sit on the throne of his father Jacob forever, of his kingdom there will be my end. It's almost like direct correspondence here. Basically, what's Gabriel saying? 2 Samuel 7, coming to fulfillment in your womb, Mary. And so Mary's learning that she's not just going to have any ordinary child, but she's going to have the long-awaited king, the fulfillment of all prophecy, the long-expected Messiah is going to come into her womb. Wow, that's incredible. If the story ended there, we've got really one of the best stories in all the Bible already, right? But then it gets even better. The angel goes on to say, oh, by the way, guess what? You're not going to have this child through ordinary natural relations. You're going to conceive by the power of the Holy Spirit. Whoa! There's never been a conception like that before. And then to top it all off, the angel comes and says, oh, and one more thing, your child, he's the Holy Son of God. Now, some of us might have kids who think they're God. But Mary's being told that her God, her creator, is going to become a little baby inside her. What a profound mystery that is. Think about all of that. The Lord be with you. You're going to have a baby. Your baby is the Messiah, the fulfillment of prophecy. You're going to conceive by the Holy Spirit as a virgin, and you are going to have the Holy Son of God. Whoa, that's a lot to take in one short conversation with an angel. If that were me, I'd probably faint. But what does Mary do? Mary gives her great fiat. Let's unpack this a little bit here. So, the angel says, let it be done unto me. Mary says, behold, I am the handmaiden of the Lord. Be it done unto me according to thy word. In Luke 1:38. First of all, let's talk about the language handmaiden. Some people translate it servant. I want you to know that language that's used there for handmaiden, you could translate it slave. Now, people tend not to do that because they don't like that word slave. But I want you just to know that this is the same word that you'll see when St. Paul describes, I'm a slave of Jesus Christ. It's the same language here. So Mary describes herself as a slave. Now, I was once giving a presentation to deacons in the diocese of Lansing, Michigan, I think it was. And I remember there was one really good, it was an amazing retreat, and there was one really good deacon who loved the scriptures, loved the Lord. But when I was teaching this, he interrupted my teaching. He just stood up and he just said, excuse me, Dr. Shree, I just have to say, I'm not comfortable with that language of slavery. I don't think we should be slaves. We should just love God freely, and we're not supposed to be slaves. I don't like that word. And I had to say, well, it's not my word, it's God's word. It's in scripture. But I said it was a really good question, though. What does Mary mean when she describes herself as a handmaiden or a servant or even a slave? Don't think of this as like a slave under some oppressive regime. It's not like that. Think of Mary more as a slave, like a lover. She's so in love with God, she can't help but serve him. Now, I want to come back to the deacon's question. You know, in our modern American understanding of freedom, you know, we pride ourselves in freedom. I want to be free. I want to be free from anyone telling me what to do. I want to be free to do whatever I want with my life and choose to do what I want for myself. It's my life. Don't let others tell you what to do. It's my life. I'm going to do what I want with it. And we think that we're free when we can just do whatever we want. I don't want the church telling me what to do. I don't want the government telling me what to do. I don't want my parents telling me what to do. It's my life. And we think we're free when we live that kind of modern American freedom. But the reality is, Mary shows us what true freedom is really all about. You see, if I'm always doing what I want, when I want, where I want, how often I want, am I really free? If I'm always doing what I want all the time, am I really free? You know what happens? If I'm doing what I want all the time, I mean, just imagine being married to someone like that. Am I free? No, I'm a slave. I'm a slave to my own comfort. I'll be a slave to my own preferences, a slave to my own interests. I'm not going to be free to make a sacrifice and serve others and give the best of myself to my wife, to my kids, to my friends, because I'm always habitually doing what I want all the time. That's the tragedy of the way we talk about freedom in our country. The biblical understanding of freedom, the classical Catholic understanding of freedom, is so much bigger. It's not about doing whatever I want all the time. True freedom is found when I develop the habits, the good habits, the virtues that enable me to make a gift of my life to God and to others. In other words, I'm not a slave to my fallen selfish desires, but I actually am able to resist my selfish temptations, selfish desires, and use my life to serve something bigger than just me. And that's what we see in Mary. You see, the Blessed Virgin Mary, she's someone who is so in love with God that she wants to just use her life not for her own purposes, but for his. And so when she sees that this is what's on God's heart, that God wants her to be the mother of the Messiah, God wants the Messiah brought into the world at this time to bring salvation to the world, she sees this, and like a lover, she just says, oh, that's what my beloved wants, then I want it too. You know, ever see two young people fall in love? So there's a couple we've known for a while. They've been dating. Now they're engaged. They're starting to plan their wedding, and they're in Denver this summer, and we've been spending a lot of time with them and this young couple, and they always have to be together. Always want to be together. Like, do you ever see a young couple like that? You know, they just have to be together. They're always, you know, going out together, hanging out together. You know, like, do you ever look at them and go, oh, how pathetic. They're just slaves. They just always have to be together. No, they're impelled by love. That's why they want to be together. And that's what's going on here with Mary. Mary calls herself the servant of the Lord, the slave of the Lord, not because she's, you know, like being oppressed, but it's more out of love. She just loves God so much. And this is what we see in all the saints. She just wants to use her life for God's purposes and not her own. I think that challenges all of us. Do you use your life to serve your own purposes or God's? I mean, we could be good Catholics, Orthodox Catholics, believe the right things, go to church on Sunday, but still carve out all this space for just, this is just what I want, and God can't touch these things. Mary wasn't like that. Mary gave everything. She says, behold, I'm the servant of the Lord, the handmaiden of the Lord, the slave of the Lord. And then she said, be it done unto me according to thy word. That expression, be it done unto me, the Greek word genoito here, describes not just like, again, passive submission. Sometimes we could think Mary was there at the Annunciation, and she says, yes, sir, I submit. Be it done unto me according to your word. We could think it was like that, but that's not what the word means. The word implies an active embrace of God's will. It's as if she's longing to do this, again, like a lover. This is what all the saints do. You know, there are many Christians that seek God for what God can do for them. Mary and all the saints look at God and they seek out and want to run after God's desires. What does God want for their life? And like a lover, that's what she's doing. She actively, joyfully does God's will. So are you someone that just does God's will, or do you do it with great joy and great love? All right, so that's the second step of faith. So first step we looked at, she has an open heart. She's open to God's will. But then the second step is that she allows God to act. She's a servant of the Lord. She allows God to act. She uses her life not for her own purposes. It's one thing to be open. That's the first step of being a Christian disciple. You're seeking God's will for your life. But it's another thing to actually allow God to act. Have you ever said one of those prayers like this? You ever said, here, God, whatever you want, you know, your will be done. Do you ever do that? That's dangerous. Be careful. Because God may call you on that. He did that with Mother Teresa. You know, when he called Mother Teresa to serve the poorest of the poor, he challenged her. He says, you know, Mother, you've always been saying, do with me whatever you will. Now let me act. So he called Mother on her prayer. And he'll do the same thing with us. Mary wasn't just open. She had a servant's heart, not just an open heart. She wanted to actually allow God to act in her life. Now, I want to move forward a little bit. I want to turn to the visitation scene. And in the visitation scene, just briefly, there's one key characteristic I like to bring out in the visitation, and it comes when we see Mary. She's coming out to meet, she's going up to Elizabeth and Ein Kerem. Anyone been to the Holy Land, by the way? You've been up to Ein Kerem, you've been where the visitation took place. Isn't that just absolutely beautiful? It's one of my favorite places. I feel like I'm in Colorado or something when I go to Ein Kerem, because there's just beautiful mountain, you got all these beautiful green trees. It's just spectacular. But you picture Mary going up this hill, and then Elizabeth coming out and meeting Mary. Now the Bible tells us that Mary greeted Elizabeth first, and that's what we would expect. The younger greeting the elder. That was what you would do to honor the elder. But what's astonishing is the way Elizabeth responds. The words Elizabeth uses next are just amazing. Elizabeth says to her, you know, why is it granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come unto me? So this is the great mother of the Lord, which is biblical expression for the queen mother, the mother of the king. Who do you call my Lord in the Bible? My Lord, the King. And for Elizabeth to call Mary, mother of my Lord, tells us that Elizabeth knows that Mary's pregnant, not with any ordinary child, but with the great Messiah. And she calls her mother of my Lord, mother of the King. In other words, you're the great queen mother. Because as you all know, the ancient Israelite kings had the mother serve as the queen. Read Scott Hahn's book on that if you want to learn more. But back to Elizabeth. Elizabeth goes on to also say, and blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. So you are blessed among all women. You're the great queen. You're the mother of my Lord. She's just getting all this great praise. How does Mary respond? Does she come back and say, thanks, Elizabeth. You know, I've been working really hard at this, and that's how I've gotten to this great role, and really proud of my efforts. And no. Mary breaks out in praise of God. She says, my soul magnifies the Lord, my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. In other words, she's directing all of this attention to God, because she knows it's God is the one who's doing these great things in her. He has regarded the low estate of his handmaiden, for behold, henceforth all generations will call me blessed. She acknowledges, yes, I am in this unique role as the mother of the Messiah, and all generations will call me blessed for this. But it's not because of me. Why are they going to call me blessed? Verse 49. Because he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. In other words, she doesn't shy away from the amazing things taking place in her womb, in her life, her mission. But she recognizes it's all from God. So what we see exhibited here in the Magnificat, and if you ever pray evening prayer and you pray this prayer regularly, think of Mary's humility here. Mary is someone who is completely convinced of her own nothingness. She's completely convinced of her own littleness. And I think it's because of that humility in Mary that God can do great things in her. So these are my words reflecting on the Magnificat. I say, Mary recognizes the truth of the human condition. She understands how small she really is. She knows that on her own, she's nothing, and that she's completely dependent on the Lord. So, you know, all of us, if I give you a quiz, I'm going to talk about this later tonight in the general session, but if I give you a quiz and said, okay, how many of you think you need God? You'd all say, yes, I think I need God, right? There's one thing to kind of understand that on a quiz, you know, get it right on a catechism test, even to say the words, but it's a whole other thing. Do you live your life that way? Like at the core of your being, are you utterly convinced of how little you are, how small you are, how little you can really do? Do you remember what Jesus says in the Gospel of John? Jesus says, without me, you can do only 50%. Is that what Jesus says? Without me, you can do nothing. Are you convinced of that? Is that the way you approach your work? You just run into work and do your work, or do you turn to God many times throughout your day at work? Jesus, help me. Help me to do this well. Help me to do this for you. I don't care if you're working in a parish or you're working in some business office or some doctor's office. Do we look at our work and just entrust it totally to God? Or, you know, the way we live our married life, Jesus, I need your help to be a better husband. Jesus, help me. I don't know how to parent through the teen years. I don't know how to parent through the tween years. Jesus, help me. Are we utterly convinced of how much we need him? Because when we go running off on our own, he'll let us just go run off on our own, and it's not going to go that great. But Mary exhibits Christ's teaching that the humble will be exalted. Only when we are convinced, like Mary was, of how little we can really do on our own and how utterly dependent we are on God, can the Lord begin to act in magnificent ways in us and through us. So the fourth step of Mary's faith life, third step is, and in the visitation, it's her humility. We see her great humility. So she's open to God's will, step one. She allows God to act. She's a servant of the Lord. She wants to use her life not for her own purposes, but for God's. And then she approaches all this humbly, recognizing she needs God's help. She can't do this all on her own. Now I'm going to come to a fourth step, and this is a very important one here. It comes at the Nativity. This is one many people overlook, but John Paul II once wrote something that really completely changed the way I look at Mary at the Nativity. You know, when you look at Mary at the Nativity, how do you picture her? You get a little Christmas card. What does she look like? What are her hands doing? She's got the, you know, here's the little manger, and her hands are like this, right? You know, or maybe they're like this, right? You see Mary there. And that's beautiful. It shows her ardent devotion to the newborn child. It's a beautiful image. And it does depict something of what happened on that first Christmas night. But there was a lot more that happened. And a lot of it was very, very dramatic, indeed traumatic. Think about what Mary was going through. Here she is in the middle of her last trimester up in Nazareth when all of a sudden soldiers from Rome come marching in and announce a great census, and Joseph has to pick up and move, and she's going to have to go follow him all the way down to Bethlehem. Now, ladies, that moms here, how would you like to move in your last trimester? Does that sound exciting? That's not really something thrilling, something you look forward to. So this would have been hard. And then Mary has to pick up, and she goes, and she's not going in a nice air-conditioned bus like you do when you go on a Holy Land pilgrimage. You know, she's going to have to go walking or on a donkey. She's going to travel down this four-day journey. And then when she gets there, what happens when she gets to Bethlehem? How is she treated? Does the Bethlehem Chamber of Commerce come out and say, oh, it's the Blessed Virgin Mary, we welcome you here, you know? No. There's no welcoming. There's no recognition. In fact, she's treated very poorly, right? She has to give birth to Jesus in conditions of great poverty, humility, and indeed, rejection. Rejection. This is the Son of God. So 9 months ago, Mary was told by the angel Gabriel, this is the Holy Son of God, the great Messiah King, and he's being treated like this. Where are all the Jewish leaders? How come they're not coming out here, welcoming him? She has to give birth to Jesus and put him in a manger, a feeding trough for the animals. John Paul II said that Mary couldn't give Jesus even the basics of what any ordinary mother would want to give her child. And yet Mary knows that this child is the Son of God. How painful this would have been for Mary. And you can picture, this would have been very perplexing. She's probably wondering, 9 months ago, Gabriel told me, this isn't what I was picturing. This isn't what I thought would happen. Why is this happening, Lord? Do you ever have moments in your life where you're wondering, Lord, what's going on here? I've been following you. I've been faithful. Why did this happen? Do you ever have the moments like that? Or do you ever have moments where you feel like you're not being treated well? You feel like you're not being treated well? You're not appreciated? You're not, recognized? And, how does Mary respond in this moment? Do we see Mary complaining? Did she say, hey, don't you know? I'm the Queen Mother. Did you see her doing that? Do you see her whining? Do you see her getting upset? You know what many of us do when things don't go well in our lives? It could be a variety of things. It could be, maybe we had a certain plan for our lives and it didn't work out. Maybe there's some big trouble at work, or there's a new boss that's come in and it's just really stressing my life out right now. Or maybe it's some financial woe, like what happened in 2008. When many of us saw our 401ks become 201ks, so maybe that's been really stressful. Or maybe it's, something going on with one of our kids and it causes us great grief. Or maybe it's a health matter with someone we love, or something going on in myself. Maybe we've even lost someone over the last year or two and we just feel our life has been turned upside down and we wonder, where is God? Lord, where are you? Why did this happen? Mary was perplexed and wondering, what is going on here? And what was her response? What we do sometimes when we experience these things, we can get really just discouraged and downhearted, can't we? We can become like Eeyore in Winnie the Pooh. His life is always so bad, and all these bad things always happen to me, and I always have to complain about my troubles. You ever meet people like that? That's one way we respond to the crosses that come in life. Another thing people do is they can get bitter. They just get bitter and hardened and angry at other people, blaming other people for their problems, and we know that's not helpful. Another thing some of us try to do, some of us, especially for kind of more like type A personalities, we just want to fix all the problems and rearrange everything and get everything just like it was before. Like my daughter Josephine wanting to go backwards to the security of the chair. But what we want to do is be like Mary, who when her legs get a little wobbly here, things are not working out the way she was expected. This isn't what she was thinking would happen. She doesn't go backwards, but she looks at this as an opportunity to go forward. What's the one response we get from Mary? It comes in Luke chapter 2, verse 19. There at the Nativity, what does she say? It says that Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. What does that expression mean, to keep and to ponder? This expression is used many times in the Bible to describe somebody that experiences a mysterious event or some type of mysterious revelation. Whether it's Jacob hearing about Joseph's dreams, or Nebuchadnezzar hearing about certain visions, Daniel having certain visions, they keep these things, meaning they're mulling it over. They're wanting to understand, what's the meaning here? What does this mean for my life? I like to think of it like this: to keep and to ponder. It's as if Mary's saying to the Lord, "Lord, what are you trying to teach me? What are you trying to show me?" You see, we should all have the confidence that no matter what's happening on the outside of our lives, God can always bring out some good on the inside, and he always wants to bring out some good on the inside. So I might not be able to control my financial portfolio, what's happening at work, what's going on with my boss, what's going on with my kids, what's going on in my marriage. I may be able to control all these things. I might not be able to control what's going on in this person's situation or their health or this moral challenge. There's things out here I might not be able to control, and it's causing me stress, it's causing me grief, causing me sorrow. And I might not be able to change all that, but I should have the confidence that whatever's happening out here, God wants to bring something good in here. So when we face those crosses in our lives, we need to be like Mary, keep and ponder, ask Jesus, Jesus, what are you trying to teach me? What are you trying to show me? You know, I often just want to fix the problem, but first the attitude is, okay, you allowed this to happen, so maybe there's a important spiritual lesson, an opportunity for me to grow here. Maybe you want me to grow in trust. Maybe, you know, you're allowing me to experience this disappointment or things not going well because, you know, maybe I've always done well, I've always succeeded, everything's always gone well for me, and now I'm experiencing a little bit of failure, and that's hard. And it's hard for me, Jesus, but you're probably helping me to grow in humility now. There's an opportunity to grow in humility. Or maybe it's to grow in patience. Maybe God's just simply wanting me to experience a bit of suffering so that I can be more compassionate on others who have greater sufferings than I do. Whatever's happening on the outside, we should always have the confidence God wants to bring something good out here. So let's keep and ponder those things in our heart. That's what Mary did. And you know what Mary discovered? I'm sure Mary, as she kept and pondered this, came to see what Luke's gospel highlights for us. Why did the Son of God enter the world this way? You know, when you read the story of the Nativity in Luke's gospel, you know, we have only one verse about the actual birth of Jesus. Did you know that? There's only one verse. It's Luke chapter 2, verse 7. We'll hear all these other things about Herod and a census, and we'll hear about angels appearing out on a shepherd's fields and shepherds coming, angels singing, all these other things going on. But the actual birth of Jesus, one little verse. Chapter 2, verse 7 in Luke's gospel says, "And Mary gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger." That's it. Isn't that funny? I mean, of all the things we could have learned about what was going on that first Christmas night, all we learned is that Mary wrapped the baby in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger. I mean, that's interesting, but there's a lot of other things I'd like to know about, like how's Joseph feeling? How was Mary feeling? Was the baby crying? What's going on? You know, did Joseph cut the cord? Did you ever wonder that? I mean, there's all these things, but all we learned is the baby was wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a manger. Why does Luke tell us those two things of all the things he could have told us? It's because if you read later in the gospel, you will find that those two verbs, wrapped and laid, are used back to back only one other time in the entirety of Luke's gospel. It's used back to back here at the Nativity, and then if you go to chapter 23, verse 53, you'll see those words again. When they are there at Good Friday, they take Jesus' body down. And what do they do with the body? They wrap the body in linen garments and laid him in a tomb, wrapped and laid. Now, when biblical authors put two key words together like this, they're often trying to make a point. What's the point Luke is making here? He's trying to make a connection between the Nativity and the crucifixion, between that first Christmas night and Good Friday. The way Jesus entered this world foreshadows how he's going to leave this world. So the Holy Son of God, the great Messiah King, enters this world with poverty, humility, rejection, to foreshadow how he's going to establish his kingdom. He is indeed the great King of Kings, but his kingdom is not of worldly glory. It's going to be made manifest through his death on the cross. Poverty, humility, rejection. John Paul II beautifully and brilliantly notes that it's here at the Nativity that Mary gets the first real share in the suffering of her son. Many of us, I think, would have said, oh, maybe it was the flight to Egypt, or maybe it was when Simeon talks about the sword. But J.P. 2 says, no, right here, It's fascinating. Now, I get to talk about Mary all the time, but with all of you, I'm giving you a little extra stuff because you guys go deeper in the scriptures. So I'm going to share something I don't share at the average like parish event or something when I go out and speak on Mary. But if you look at chapter 2, verse 7, what does the text say? It says, Mary wrapped the babe. Mary gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, for there was no room for them in the inn. Now, when you read that line, there's no room for them in the inn. Who do you think the them is? I always thought it was Mary and Joseph, right? But read that sentence carefully. Is Joseph's name even mentioned? Who are the two people mentioned in that verse? Mary gave birth to her firstborn son, Mary and the son. Mary wrapped the baby in swaddling clothes and laid him in the manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Who's the them? Mary and Jesus. So in other words, Luke is deliberately drawing a connection between Mary and her son Jesus here at this point of suffering, rejection, poverty, humility. And St. John Paul II brings this out that what Luke is trying to show us is Mary, it's underscoring Mary's participation in the suffering of her son already. It's this beautiful little point for them is really Mary and Jesus. Now, it's interesting, there's a Methodist scholar that also kind of made this connection. This is fascinating as well. But I want to turn, we only have a little bit of time, and I want to leave you with a little bit of time for questions and answers as well. Can I do one more point with you, though? Could we go 40 days later to the presentation? I think we should at least get there. So let's go to a next step of faith, the fifth step of faith. At the presentation, Simeon and the sword. You know the story. Mary, 40 days later, she goes up for this ritual and to present the firstborn son and for her own ritual purification. And as she's going up the steps, a complete stranger comes up to her. And I want you just to picture the scene. She doesn't know this old man. She's never met him before. And all of a sudden, this stranger comes up and takes the baby out of her arms. But just imagine how dramatic that is. I'd be like, what are you doing? but then this man says, and now at last your servant can go in peace according to your word, as he's talking to God. For my eyes have seen your revelation, a light of revelation to the Gentiles and glory for your people Israel. So he's praising God for finally being able to lay eyes on the Messiah. Because as you know, Simeon was given this extraordinary revelation that he wouldn't die until he saw the Messiah. And now on this day, he's holding the Messiah in his arms. So now we can say, at last your servant could go in peace. So that's the first prophecy. So this would be great words of confirmation for Mary, that indeed, yes, this is the child fulfilling all prophecy. But then he all of a sudden directs the next prophecy specifically to Mary and says to Mary, this child is destined for the rise and fall of many in Israel. He shall be a sign that is contradicted, and a sword will pierce your soul also. What do these words mean? These stark, ominous words pierced Mary indeed that day. Let's break them down. First of all, rise and fall of many in Israel. This describes how there are going to be many people that are going to be raised up in Christ's kingdom. The poor, the Gentiles, the sinners, all the outcasts are going to be raised up in Christ's kingdom, whereas many of the wealthy and the Jewish leaders of Jesus' day, they're going to reject Christ and they're going to be cast down. There's going to be great turmoil surrounding your son's ministry, Simeon's telling Mary. And then this child will be a sign that is contradicted. A sign that is contradicted. Now, that this language for a sign contradiction is the word in Greek antilego, which means to speak against. But it's used in Luke's gospel consistently, not just to describe, you know, saying bad things about someone, like some bully on a playground or something. No, it's more describing, and Luke uses it, to describe the Jewish leaders gathering together to conspire against Jesus, to plot his death. Every time in Luke's gospel you see this word used, it's always used to describe the Jewish leaders gathering together to plot against Jesus. So imagine Mary hearing these words. And then, to top it all off, the angel uses the image of a sword. A sword will pierce your soul also. Now, the image of a sword can bring to mind war, bloodshed, death. And of course, we know it's pointing forward to the sword that will pierce Jesus on Good Friday. And Mary will undergo a spiritual crucifixion, if you will, on that day. That sword that pierces Christ will pierce Mary's own soul also. These are intense words. And to kind of make it come to light, just imagine if at the local hospital here in Steubenville, there's a young mom in the maternity ward, and she's there holding her baby, and all of a sudden, some strange prophet figure comes in, takes the baby out of her arms, and says, this child's destined for all these great things, to renew America, all this. But then all of a sudden, then he says, but he's going to be hated. People are going to oppose him. There's going to be great turmoil surrounding his ministry. People are going to speak against him and plot his death. And one day, he'll be killed. And a spiritual bullet will pierce your soul also. Could you imagine hearing those kinds of words? That would be so hard. If that were me, you know what I would do? I would say, okay, I'm taking this baby. We're moving to Montana. You know, we're going to dig a big bunker. We're going to hide. You know, because I want to hold on to my child, you know, protect my child. But that's not what Mary does. You know, some beautiful things we could think about here at the end with this oracle about Mary and the sword. First of all, it's interesting, this language of a sword will pierce your soul. In the Septuagint, in the Old Testament, we find these same two words, soul and sword, right side by side in the famous Psalm 22. Psalm 22, where the psalmist, if you remember the Psalm 22, is the one, my God, why have you abandoned me? It's a foreshadowing of it's a righteous man suffering to the brink where he's wondering, where is God? But he totally trusts himself to God and trusts that God's going to vindicate him and rescue him. And it foreshadows the cross because it goes on in Psalm 22 to describe how this man says, my hands and my feet have been pierced and that my garments have been divided, and for my raiment they cast lots. And so it's a prophecy about what's going to happen to the ultimate righteous man, Jesus Christ, who dies on Good Friday. But in the midst of the psalm, Psalm 22, verse 20, the persecuted man says, deliver my soul from the sword. And so I think what we're seeing here is this is certainly a foreshadowing of Jesus' death on the cross. And when we read that a sword is going to pierce Mary's soul, it's highlighting her own participation in that suffering that her son will go through. But what I think is most fascinating is this. In Luke's gospel, the only other time we read about a person's soul, there's only one other time in all of Luke's gospel that we read about a person's soul. Who is it? This is fascinating. You know, there's other times where Jesus uses the same word for soul, but he talks about it in a generic sense, like you have to save your soul. Or he talks about you shall love the Lord your God with all your soul. But in Luke's gospel, there's only one individual person whose soul is mentioned, and it's Mary. Mary's soul is the only person who we learn something about their soul in Luke's gospel, and we learn about it twice. When's the other occasion? Do you remember? The one other time we hear about Mary's sword. We've already looked at this passage. The Magnificat, right? The Magnificat, Luke 1:46. What does Mary say? My soul magnifies the Lord. So to magnify, to make great, Mary desires to make God great in her soul. How does she do this? Do you desire to make God great in your soul? Do you want God to be reflected in your soul? If you do, what do you need to do? Look at Mary. I think here's one spiritual connection we can make. Is that Mary in the Magnificat wants to make God great in her soul. And then that's the first time we read about her soul. My soul magnifies the Lord. How does she make God great in her soul? What's the second time we learn about soul? Simeon and the sword. Mary wants to make God great in her soul. And how is she going to do it? Through sharing in the sword. Through participating in her son's own suffering. Here's my closing little exhortation for all of you, practical point here, is that, you know, on Good Friday, Jesus was very alone. There were few people that stood by him on Good Friday. There were many people that followed him during his public ministry when they saw his amazing teaching. Wow, this man teaches with authority. And they saw all of his signs and wonders and says, wow, this is amazing. We've never seen anything like this in all of Israel. All the crowds are all excited. But on Good Friday, he was very alone. Mother Teresa used to reflect on this point about how alone Jesus was. That on this day, he looked out for someone to comfort him, and he found no one. And there was a little holy card that showed Jesus at that moment when Pilate says, Ecce homo, here's the man. And then there was a scripture verse from the Old Testament. I looked for someone to comfort me and found no one. You know what Mother Teresa used to do? She had hundreds and hundreds of these holy cards, and she would write the words, be the one, and hand them out to all of her sisters. I looked for someone to comfort me, but I found no one. Be the one, she said. Be the one. She said, people follow Jesus for what he can do for them, but very few people are willing to be with Jesus in his own suffering on Good Friday. And she wrote to her sisters about how, you know, she said, be the one to be with Jesus. Mary was there at the cross. But if you get close to Jesus, if you get close to Jesus on Good Friday, you know what's going to happen? Ow! The nails are going to hurt you, Mother Teresa says. If you want to kiss Jesus on Good Friday, the thorns are going to cut into you. Do you love Jesus? And Mother Teresa said, when we share in suffering, suffering is simply the kiss of Jesus. But if we allow Jesus to kiss us, it's going to hurt. If we get close to the suffering Jesus on Good Friday. And so Mary was someone who exhibited this point that Mother Teresa was writing about, that she wanted to be the one. And indeed, she was there, as we know, with her son on Good Friday. So even though she had full knowledge now from Simeon of where this is going, she probably was putting pieces together from the prophecies and everything else, but now it's explicit. Your son is going to be hated, opposed, plotted against, and will be killed, and a sword will pierce your soul also. And Mary doesn't run away from that. She doesn't go backwards. She moves forwards with full knowledge of where this is all going to go. Imagine the burden of that prophecy for the next 30 years that Mary's going to carry, and then watching the public ministry, again knowing it's all going to lead ultimately to his death. But she still said yes. Now, there's so much more I'd like to cover, but I'm going to take time for just maybe two or three quick questions here. So we have a microphone. If we want to go, maybe, do you want them to come up, or are you going to go to them? Okay, if you can come on up right here. And while the people are coming up for the questions, can I just mention to you a couple things? So everything I've been sharing with you is from this book here, Walking with Mary. And I know they have these in the bookstore. So it walks through all 9 steps, not just in Luke's gospel, but gets into John as well. How many of you are familiar with the video study that we have out on Mary? There's a Bible study we have on Mary with Ascension Press. We filmed in the Holy Land. And so we got to film right at Calvary. We got to film right along the Sea of Galilee, all the places related to Mary, Ein Kerem. One of my favorite points was to be able to film right where the Annunciation took place. Most people, you just see. Oh, the Annunciation took place through that gate over there. But I heard there was an Italian abbot that was in charge of the basilica. And I speak a little Italian, and I thought, I also know how Italians can be with rules. Così. Says, I'm just going to ask him, can we go in there? And I talked to him, and sure enough, he said, oh, well, it's not structurally sound, but maybe just for 5 minutes we go in. He let us stay for 20. It was amazing. We are in the little place. I mean, this is the actual walls where Mary lived and the Annunciation took place. It was just utterly amazing. So if you want to just not just do a Bible study, but have like a visual pilgrimage and be able to show, you know, children and all, hey, these are all the sites of the Holy Land, check out that study. It's called Mary, A Biblical Walk with the Blessed Mother. You can get it through Ascension Press. So those are the two resources related to our talk.